Good evening, and welcome to the New York Society for Ethical Culture. My name is Anne Clayson. I'm one of the leaders here, and it is a great privilege for me to welcome you to our meeting house. This is the home of a philosophy and a community founded in 1876 by Felix Adler, a young man who had the radical idea of putting deed above creed. He invited people who held different or no religious beliefs to meet him on the common ground of ethics and to partner with him to create an ethical culture. I too invite you to partner with us as we are doing this evening with Planned Parenthood Federation of America to make ethics our common ground and our common language. Our connection to Planned Parenthood goes back many years, and certainly many of our members were involved in the earliest days of Planned Parenthood. As you know, Planned Parenthood is celebrating 100 years of existence. Yes. Our national organization, the American Ethical Union, made a formal resolution in 1958 that says, in part, "The American Ethical Union joins the board of directors of the International Humanist and Ethical Union in recognizing that population pressures in many parts of the world constitute an increasing threat to human dignity and welfare. We feel that every child should be a wanted child with the great possibilities for the fullest growth and development of the whole person. The suppression or withholding of information compounds the threat by depriving free peoples of full knowledge and understanding upon which they can make free choices." So the New York Society Women's Conference decided in 1959, they helped to develop the Planned Parenthood Clinic right here on the Upper West Side. In fact, it was on the corner of Broadway and 84th Street. It's a great privilege for me to welcome to our stage now our moderator and panelists. So our moderator for this evening is Alencia Johnson. Alencia is the director of Constituency Communications, Planned Parenthood Federation. She's responsible for national communications, engaging communities of color and new audiences. She's a spokesperson for Planned Parenthood, and she's worked together to make strategies for African Americans on the national front. By the way, she was named to Ebony Magazine's Power 100 of the most influential African Americans. So she will be moderating our panel. You can read their bios in your program, so I'm just going to invite them up. We first have Jennifer Dalvin, and she's a director of the ACLU Reproductive Freedom Project. Katie McDonough, who's a journalist. Dr. Natalie Oley with Physicians for Reproductive Health. Sarah Hutchinson Ratcliffe, Program Director, Catholics for Choice. And Stephanie Todi, Senior Counsel, Center for Reproductive Rights. Thank you so much for joining us this evening, and I know we're going to have a wonderful discussion.
Thank you, Anne. We are excited to be here and truly honored as an organization to receive this award. And I want to actually just get right into our topic, the politicizing of women's health and sexuality, as that has been a conversation, a national conversation, of course, most recently, but actually over the past few decades. And today we are sitting here, I don't like to call it an anniversary, but 40 years since the dangerous, dehumanizing Hyde Amendment was passed. So I want us to really get into some of the nuances of what is happening and limiting access to care for women who are in need. So Jennifer, I want to start with you. ACLU, you all are doing amazing work and pushing back against the restrictions we see in several states. Can you talk about what's happening at the state level? There is, you know, under President Obama, who is very open to access to reproductive health care. Some members of Congress are, some aren't. But if we really look at the state level, that's where they're chipping away at their rights. If you could talk about that a bit.
Oh, I'd love to. But before I do, I just want to say how honored I am to be here to help celebrate Planned Parenthood. Planned Parenthood is just a national treasure and a critical piece of our healthcare infrastructure. The folks who work there are some of the most courageous, compassionate, and committed people you could ever hope to know, from the doctors and the nurses and the staff at the health centers to the lawyers and the policy folks in the back rooms fighting against abortion restrictions, and especially over the last year when they've been targeted with this just unbelievable witch hunt. I'm just really glad to be here. They're national heroes, and I'm happy to be here to celebrate with them. But getting back to your question, I really love the focus on the states, because so often we're talking about the federal government. And really, since 1973, at the state level, there's been restriction after restriction passed, especially since the 2010 elections. Since that time, there have been 334 new obstacles passed that stand in the way of a woman getting the health care that she needs. Things like mandatory ultrasound laws, clinic shutdown laws, various forms of abortion bans, and on and on and on. And so today, while Roe is the law of the land, whether you can get an abortion really depends often on where you live and how much money you have. It's sometimes hard for some of us in New York to try to understand what that looks like. So if you would bear with me, I'll give you a sense of, I work a lot in Alabama. We've sued that state 5 times in the last 3 years. Here's what it looks like if you're a woman in Alabama. If you use Medicaid as your health insurance, you have no coverage for abortion. If you have a private plan, the state also bans abortion coverage. If you can come up with the money before you get your abortion, you have to make a separate trip to the clinic to get state-mandated information, go home, take another day off of work, find somebody to watch your kids again, and get back to the clinic. The doctor has to describe your ultrasound to you. If your doctor wants to provide medication through telemedicine, as he or she can for all other sorts of medical services, can't do that. If you happen to need an abortion past 20 weeks, you got to go out of state. If you're a teen who can't turn to her parents safely, you've got to go to a judge and get permission to get your abortion. And when you do, the district attorney will be there, and the judge can also appoint a guardian for the fetus to oppose your request. Alabama also passed a Texas-style clinic shutdown law. We challenged that with Planned Parenthood. But for that lawsuit, there would be one doctor in the whole state who could provide abortions. And if that weren't enough, Alabama was one of the many states last year that tried to kick Planned Parenthood out of the Medicaid program. And then this year, they passed 2 new laws, one that would ban a medically proven method of abortion, and the second that would shut down 2 of the 5 clinics in the state. And we'll be in court challenging those laws next week. And I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, well, I understand, that's Alabama. That's different. But in fact, over half of the states have restrictive laws like that, unnecessary, excessive obstacles to women's access to abortion. We're seeing it everywhere from Alaska to Florida, Arizona to Wisconsin. So that's the bad news. But there's good news. In June, we've got a great decision from the Supreme Court, and we are very lucky today to have the lawyer who litigated that case and who argued it before the Supreme Court with us, Stephanie Todi from the Center for Reproductive Rights. And of course, there's a vacancy on the Supreme Court. And depending on how that gets filled, the pendulum might start to swing back the other way. So I've been doing this work for almost 20 years, and I have never been more excited about the possibilities for us to move forward.
Thank you, Jennifer, and you brought up something we would love to talk about, and I'm going to hand it over to you, Stephanie, and of course, we thank you for all of your great work these past few years, but really, let's talk about what happened in Texas in the Supreme Court decision, and then also thinking about that Supreme Court vacancy and what that will look like in the future for what we know could be more cases like this.
Well, great. I'd like to say that I'm also thrilled to be here tonight to help celebrate the incredible work that Planned Parenthood does, and also that it's just an incredible honor to be here on this panel with such a group of smart and talented women. So yes, we had a big victory at the Supreme Court in June. The court decided a case called Whole Woman's Health versus Hellerstedt, which was about the constitutionality of a pair of Texas laws that imposed medically unnecessary requirements on the provision of abortion care in Texas. And the laws, if implemented, would have caused more than 75% of the state's abortion facilities to close down. So it would have left a state with 5.4 million women of reproductive age, where on average 70,000 abortions per year are performed, with only 9 healthcare providers legally eligible to provide abortion care in the entire state. So the situation would have been quite catastrophic. The Supreme Court thankfully stepped in and declared these medically unnecessary restrictions unconstitutional. And in doing so, it did two important things. First, it reaffirmed more than 40 years of precedent holding that access to safe abortion care is a fundamental right under the Constitution. And second, it strengthened the legal protections for that right. And the court said, in particular, that laws restricting access to abortion are unconstitutional unless it can be proven by credible evidence that they will confer burdens that are sufficient to that they will confer benefits that are sufficient to justify the burdens that they impose on women. And this is a tremendously powerful tool in the fight against restrictive abortion laws, because as Jen was saying, we see these laws all across the country and we fight them every day in court. And up till now, courts in some states have been willing to uphold these laws based on nothing more than junk science and rank speculation that maybe these laws will help women, maybe there's some medical benefit. There's not really any credible science justifying that, but we're going to defer to the state's opinion about it. That can't happen anymore. So this decision gives us a really incredible tool that we can use to go across the country and try to dismantle the infrastructure of restrictive laws that are on the books that are preventing women from full access to safe and legal abortion care. But our fight is far from over because proponents of anti-abortion legislation aren't going to give up. And so we're going to have to continue to beat back these laws one by one, state by state. And that's why the vacancy currently on the Supreme Court is so critical. How that vacancy gets filled will determine how accountable states and politicians will be for unconstitutional laws in the future. The Constitution is an amazing document that confers rights on all of us, but those rights are only as good as the courts that are willing to enforce them. And so it's really critical for us moving forward in order to maintain the protections that we have and to continue expanding those protections so that full access to safe abortion care is a reality for every woman in this country. We need a justice that recognizes the importance of those rights and cares about how the law impacts the real lives of everyday people.
Thank you. Thank you, Stephanie. See, you were talking about the legality of this, but you mentioned the real lives of people, and I want to pivot to you, our physician, representing our physicians on the stage, Dr. Oley. What do these restrictions really mean in your ability to provide care to your patients and what you're seeing? You know, you practice here in New York, and as Jen said, we feel a bit more privileged here in New York, but you've also practiced in Pennsylvania. So could you share what this actually looks like for your patients and the perspectives that you're seeing?
Absolutely. I'd like to also mirror my colleagues at the table and really send an appreciation to the organization of Planned Parenthood for everything that they do. I'm honored to be here as part of this discussion. When I was in college, I was an escort at Planned Parenthood. When I saw the protesters standing outside, I knew that this was a place where I could make a difference, and it felt right to engage in this kind of work. So consistently through my career, I was sort of guided by that initial experience. So I'm grateful on many levels to Planned Parenthood. But in my medical training, I did work in Pennsylvania, and I worked with some incredible attendings, kind, compassionate, empathetic. But when it came to issues around abortion in a university-based hospital, the amount of pressure that these kind, incredible teachers felt, filling out the documentation to justify, because of the Hyde Amendment, justify the need for the patient to get an abortion if it was only for rape, incest, or threat to the mother's life. The amount of pressure that they felt that they would have to justify or be called to provide further detail because the state would only pay for it under those circumstances. It actually turned a lot of providers that were skilled, had the actual skills, which is, we know, a dwindling skill set in this country. It turned them away from providing services. That was devastating as a trainee to see that happening. Luckily, I'm in a fortunate position here in New York where the patients that we see can apply for Medicaid if they're pregnant, and they can have their procedures covered, they can have their prenatal care covered on the spot. So whichever choice they choose, it is covered. But even in this state, there are great restrictions. I work at Kings County Hospital in Central Brooklyn and started a second trimester abortion service. To do that requires a lot of buy-in from everyone that staffs those cases. So circulating nurses, scrub techs, environmental services, the chief of service, everybody. Everyone has to care. Everyone has to believe this is the right thing to do. But even in our privileged state of New York, there were great challenges that we all had to face to try to get services off the ground. So when I look at my colleagues in the rest of the country, I don't know how they do it, and they're doing it with such dignity and such grace to continue to provide services and to try to do what they can do with what they've got. So the challenges are many, and that's even just from the provider perspective.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you. Mm-hmm. So in all of this backlash and all of these restrictions against access to abortion care, and actually not just abortion care, reproductive health care as a whole, and abortion care is part of basic health care. Katie, I want to ask you, in this conversation around opposition towards women determining their own destiny and the families that they want to have, what has helped shift the narrative in support of women having that access to making their own decisions?
I think it's actually a couple of things that are happening simultaneously. I think one of the things that you're seeing politically right now is that the Democratic Party is finding itself a lot more accountable to its constituencies, which have said for a long time that this is not, the Hyde Amendment, for example, doesn't represent its interests. So you have a really broad-based reproductive health movement, reproductive justice movement that has become really difficult to... mic closer. Here we go. Thank you. So I think that, just to repeat what I said, I think that you are seeing a really powerful movement in the states, particularly around the visibility of Texas and other places where you know, access has become unignorable as an issue. I think you're seeing the Democratic Party specifically respond to that. You know, this is an unprecedented election for a number of reasons. Of course, we have the first woman as a nominee of a major party, but at the same time, for the first time in its history, the Democratic Party has embraced as part of its platform the repeal of the Hyde Amendment and the Helms Amendment, which is basically Hyde internationally. And this is unprecedented, and this is responsive to the movements that are happening across the country, frankly, because this is access that I think it's impossible, it's become impossible for them to ignore. I think the second piece is that in my own industry, I write for an outlet called Fusion. Before that, I was at Salon.com. You're seeing, I think, journalists themselves take this, take these issues much more seriously, and I think the reporting around these issues has become considerably more sophisticated, particularly over the last 6 years, as you're seeing states like Texas, Alabama, Mississippi roll back access so considerably that the human toll has become, I think, really the focus in a lot of what my own reporting is. So, you know, when I hear Jen talking about her work in Alabama, or, you know, just what the ACLU is doing there, thinking about the two 17-year-olds that I met in my own reporting who had to lie to their parents about what they were doing after school, drive 2 hours to Montgomery to a clinic that was the only clinic in their area, and then find out if she was early enough along in her pregnancy that she wouldn't have to go through the judicial bypass process, which would be putting her in front of that judge. So she was able to wait, you know, I think it was 2 weeks until her 18th birthday to have the procedure. But I think that the reporting, and hopefully what I think other journalists in this field are doing with their work, is to really put those stories in the front so that it's not just about the policy piece, it's not just about what can be, I think, frankly, a dizzying judicial process that you see these laws winding through, but also who are the people who are actually most affected and what are their stories here.
Yeah, that piggybacks off of something an activist said to me. She's like, you know, I tell people all the time, you actually love someone who has had an abortion, as one in three women have had an abortion. But speaking of the human element, I want to ask you, Sarah, representing Catholics for Choice, the morality behind this, the piece that's often missing, as, you know, I share with everyone, I'm a person of deep faith. I come from a religious background. My father's a pastor, and that's led me and all of us, many of us, to this work, but sometimes it's taken over by opposition to this care. And so where is the morality and the humanizing of this work, particularly for people of faith or spirituality?
First, I'm just going to be last to the table, but to say thank you to both the Society and to Planned Parenthood for their work. I was raised by a very feminist, raised Catholic mom who taught me Helen Reddy far before she taught me, I think, how to talk. So I really appreciated that. And my first reproductive healthcare was at a Planned Parenthood Center. And I'm both my work and in person. It's really been an important organization. I think that the reality is different than the perception when it comes to the morality of the work that abortion providers, reproductive health advocates, and people who seek reproductive health care come from. In the Catholic space, there are about 300 bishops in the United States, Catholic bishops. There are about 80 million Catholics. And we as a whole are the church, as much as the bishops and those who pontificate about what and how Catholics believe. So the myth is that all Catholics are anti-choice. The myth is that all Catholics believe X and Y and Z. But the reality is Catholic women seek abortion at exactly the same rates as women of other faiths and women who have no particular faith. Catholic women use birth control at the same rates as everyone else. And many of the providers in Catholic healthcare settings or in other traditions come to this work because of their faith. We often say that we do the work that we do at Catholics for Choice because of our faith, not in spite of it. And it really is true that most of the people who are of faith, whether they're advocates or providers or part of the work to actually provide the care, they are called to this work for that. So I think the morality of both the work and the issue, it's the perception versus the reality that's the problem, not that there's an immoral or amoral issue.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And so what, as we are talking, most everyone brought up the Hyde Amendment, and today is the 40 years since its passage. From each of you, and I would be glad to hear from almost all of you on this, but as we are talking about not only the Democratic Party platform, and make sure we stay very C3, respecting organizations on this, has called for the repeal of the Hyde Amendment, but it's also activists and advocates, particularly reproductive justice community, and shout out to All Above All for their work over decades for this. But what is most exciting about ending the Hyde Amendment and understanding that this is a dangerous, disastrous, dehumanizing amendment that has been in place for 40 years, denying people of care? What is so intriguing and exciting about the conversation and the push to repeal this?
I'll start, because I'm sure everybody has a part of it, but I mean, I think the society certainly started with the idea that social justice is an important value, an important American value. It certainly is a Catholic value. And as Anne said, if you have a right that's even guaranteed by the Constitution, it doesn't actually help you if you don't have access to do it, if you can't afford to exercise that right. So the fact that women of means, or women who live in New York City, or women who live in a different state, or women who live in the neighboring state can get services that women who have to rely on Medicaid, or women who work for the federal government, or women who are in the military, or women who are in the Peace Corps, or that you get different rights because of where your money comes from or where your insurance comes from. That's not right. That's morally wrong. And so I think that the idea that the Hyde Amendment protects taxpayer money from something that's immoral is becoming not the story. The story is becoming the people who are affected by these awful policies, by these cruel policies, whether that's the work that's being done by the coalition that's lifting up voices of young women and women of color and people who are in rural areas, or whether it's the work that we all are doing to lift up the voices of faith, saying, no, we believe that it's important, right? So I think that the Hyde Amendment and the shift, both in the election and in the work that's been done leading up to it, leading up to the platform change, really has been about changing the story and people meeting that one in three that needs these services. I think that the fight for marriage equality was a good example, that when people got to meet someone who those laws affected, they realized it's the same thing. One in three women of reproductive age will have an abortion in her lifetime. You all know someone who had one, and whether or not they speak about it and whether or not they were able to pay for it on their own is the story that we need to tell.
Anyone else?
Sure. I think it's absolutely infuriating that the government is imposing arbitrary barriers to women accessing a service that's so fundamental to their own self-determination. When we were litigating the Texas case, over the course of the litigation, the laws we were challenging were allowed to take partial effect. And this led for a time to the closure of roughly half the abortion clinics in the state. And what we saw happening during that time is that women who could afford to travel out of state, because the closure of these clinics was putting huge pressure on the ones that remained open, and the wait times became staggering because there was a shortage of providers. So in some parts of the state, women had to wait 2 to 3 weeks just to get an initial appointment. And in other parts of the state, there were no remaining clinics at all, and women would have to travel hundreds of miles to get to the nearest clinic where there was a 3-week wait time. So what we saw was that women who had the means to travel were leaving Texas to have abortions. And we heard dozens of stories about women going to New York and California and Florida to access safe abortion care. But women without the means were either being delayed much later into their pregnancies, being denied abortion care altogether, and carrying an unwanted pregnancy to term. In a state, mind you, that has a maternal mortality rate that's higher than most of the developing world. And we were also seeing many women trying to take matters into their own hands and using drugs purchased on the internet or trafficked across the border from Mexico to try to end their pregnancies, as well as more invasive means than that. And so there was essentially a two-tiered healthcare system where women with resources could get exactly the procedure that they needed, but women without resources were left with much worse options. And this is essentially what the Hyde Amendment does all across the country, is it takes away important options for women who have the fewest resources. And it's absolutely infuriating, it's unjust, and it should not continue.
Go ahead.
So I just wanted to build on that a little bit and maybe provide a little historical context. So after Roe was decided, Medicaid covered abortion, right? You know why? Because Medicaid covers health care that people need. And one in three women need an abortion. And so Medicaid covered abortion. Until 1976, when the Hyde Amendment was first passed. I just want to read you some of the words. So Representative Henry Hyde, obviously the author of the amendment, says, "I certainly would like to prevent, if I could legally, anybody from having an abortion, a rich woman, a middle-class woman, or a poor woman. Unfortunately, the only vehicle available is the Medicaid bill." So he knew exactly what he was doing. He knew, and Congress knows every year when they repass the Hyde Amendment, exactly what they're doing. This isn't about some conversation about taxpayer funding. This is about preventing women who are struggling to get by from getting the care that they need. Alencia, you were talking about why this is such an exciting time. Well, it really is. We've really seen a tremendous shift in the last few years, due in large part to a huge coalition of reproductive justice advocates and folks around the nation in pushing on this. We've got 15 states that have restored coverage for Medicaid coverage for abortion, including New York, some of them for decades, and some of them were working to get newer ones. We've got cases in Alaska and Maine right now trying to get coverage there. And we're seeing cities across the country, people speaking up, speaking out, and saying that this is wrong. Just this week, Boston and Philadelphia, I believe, passed city council resolutions calling for the repeal of Hyde. And there's been new polling out showing that the American public is with us. The American public does not agree with Hyde. There was a recent poll of folks in battleground states. Three quarters of them don't agree with the values underlying Hyde. Three quarters of them say that women should be able to get the abortion care they need no matter their income, and that this and that the government shouldn't get in the way. And we just need our politicians, as we keep speaking out, our politicians will hear this, and we'll see more and more of these city council resolutions, and eventually, hopefully, repeal of the Hyde Amendment. There's a bill in Congress right now, the Each Woman Act. You can find out more about that on the All Above All website. And it would repeal Hyde and it restore insurance coverage for abortion.
Jen, you brought up something that I like to talk about when we're talking about the pushback and the politicizing of women's health and sexuality, is that the conversation tends to be among politicians, among white male politicians in Washington, D.C., and would love to hear, Katie, from you, your perspective as a journalist, and then also from you as our physician, Dr. Oley, how this impacts the way that women are feeling when they're accessing care, to know that they're not represented in the conversation, and we aren't represented in the conversation.
I mean, I can speak as from a personal place that it feels disorienting to see legislation made by people who, I mean, I think it's fascinating, the state level lawmakers who are making public health policy. There's, you know, one of the women who passed a bill in Tennessee that criminalizes drug use during pregnancy. It basically, a woman can face jail time, is a singer-songwriter small business owner, and she's making public health policy against the advice of public health advocates and people who, you know, actually know this know the medicine. So I think that it's just disorienting to see that. But I think that from the perspective of you're seeing this shift, you're seeing a sense of, I think, public accountability about people who are not coming from medical fields, people who are actually blatantly ignoring what the medical evidence is on these issues and saying, we actually would like to see medicine, science, and ourselves represented in our policy. And just to the question that you were on just a second ago, I think that the thing about the move towards the repeal of Hyde in the Democratic platform that's interesting and notable, again, about this election is that it exists in a matrix of policy issues around it that really have shown the reproductive justice movement getting its foot so thoroughly in the door of this election. So you're looking at, you know, universal child care being on the table. You're looking at the $15 minimum wage being on the table. I think you're seeing this in a larger and broader conversation about what it means to be a person who can become pregnant, about a person who may want a family, who may want to delay having a family, and you're not seeing abortion or access to abortion isolated as this sort of narrow niche issue, which I think for a number of years it really was sidelined and not talked about as an economic justice issue, not talked about as a public health issue, and I think that you're seeing that shift. I mean, even a couple of years ago, Democrats were calling this settled law, right? This is a yearly renewal. The Hyde Amendment is like a ritual that needs to be repeated on an annual basis in order to exist. And this is the first year in which you are seeing Democratic politicians, a majority of them, put themselves on the line and say, this is not good policy, and we stand against it. So I think that some of these things, even 3 years ago, I think may have seemed politically unimaginable.
Just to go back to what the repeal of Hyde might look like, I see patients all the time that I wonder what their experience would be like if they didn't live in the state of New York. But just early this month, the start of school, an exciting time, kids going back to school, I was seeing patients in the office for screening visits for abortion care. And there was a 14-year-old who, when I got talking to her, she was in the second trimester, she was in New York, she had an address down the street, and I was asking her just a few questions about getting back to school, do you need a note to get you out of school just so that nobody asks you any questions or gives you a hard time? And she said, no, that's okay, it's in Atlanta. I was like, oh, school's in Atlanta, but you're living here. So she had a mom who has relatives that live in Brooklyn, who had the resources, the wherewithal, the childcare for the rest of her family that could move up to New York for this short period of time for a second trimester abortion, which takes at least 2, if not 3 days to accomplish for a 14-year-old who's missing the start of school. And that is the good version of what happened for her. She had compassionate, safe care in a hospital because she had access to that because of the situation she was in. And that's appalling, to say the least. When I think about what that means to patients, how people are deciding the outcome of their reproductive health and their own self-determination, people that have no idea about the story or trajectory of their lives, I see patients all the time that say, I heard you were really nice. I'm so glad that I feel safe here. There's no other field in medicine where people show up in their doctor's office and are cautious and nervous and hope that their doctor is really nice and they feel lucky to be taken care of. It breaks my heart every day when patients feel like it is not their right, that they feel it is their luck to get health care. People are not making those decisions for them. The people that are making these decisions don't know these patients, don't know us. And it is so corrupt, I don't even know where to start. It's a good thing I'm not a lawyer. I wouldn't be good at it, because I'd start crying all the time. It's a good thing I'm a doctor, because I could do that stuff. So I am so appreciative to everyone at this table for what they do, because unless these things change, we just see the volume. We just see the volume of patients, and we try to accommodate everybody as best we can, because that's what we do. But we have to fight this fight.
Sarah, did you want to join in?
I just wanted to say, I think that to build on Katie, we are fighting the fight. And as probably the only one who's doing that work in Washington with our wonderful colleagues in the United States Congress.
We have
many, many wonderful colleagues in the United States Congress. There are 120 co-sponsors to the Each Woman Act. There are folks who, like Jan Schakowsky of Chicago, like Jerry Nadler of New York, who stand up and say, no, this is wrong, we've had enough, we're not going to let you spread these bad policies into other areas anymore. And I think that never underestimate the ability for certain politicians to be tone deaf to women's needs. That's certainly something that continues to happen to this day, if any of you watched television last week. So I think that the reality that the people who are making these laws and perpetuating these laws and continuing these bad policies are disconnected from the people who affect them.
Right.
And eventually, what we need to do, again, is lift up the voices of those folks who are affected and lift up the voices of those constituents to tell politicians who do continue these bad policies that you as the voter don't want this, and that you want your values to be legislated rather than someone else's theology or ideology.
I think what was interesting last week in the hearing around the Each One Act, and some of these politicians were trying to shame women, and then they were equating abortion to slavery and black genocide, and Kiera Johnson from Urge said, it's interesting you bring up slavery because you making decisions about my healthcare means that you are trying to own me. And just that pushback from a woman of color to say, listen to me, this is my experience, was so powerful. And so I wonder, Roe v. Wade has been law of the land for over 40 years. Then, of course, a few years later, the Hyde Amendment started chipping away at that. And I recall my grandmother passed a few years ago, and she said, God, in the 50s and 60s and 70s, I was fighting against all of these things and fighting for women's rights and civil rights, so you didn't have to, but you're in the thick of this now. Where did this extreme opposition come from? I have my own opinion, but I would love to hear from some of you all where you think this extreme opposition to women controlling our lives and being a full human came from.
Well, I will not take credit, but I will tell you that the Hyde Amendment mostly came to be because the U.S., what is now the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops, worked with Henry Hyde to make it so. The many of the laws that have happened were because the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops and the National Right to Life and the Evangelical Christian Right Christian Coalition, over the course of decades, moved the needle on what was acceptable to get elected and how that was politically scored. But none of that really speaks to what we're talking about, which is women's autonomy, which is most people believe in. To force a woman to have a child she doesn't want, isn't ready for, can't afford, is unconscionable. End of sentence. And for most politicians or voters, when you say that to them, they understand it differently. And so I think part of it is on us as advocates to talk about what these laws do to the patients and how these politicians' opinions are affecting the daily lives, and then it will make sense, because the impetus to legislate religious beliefs or legislate morality or legislate what I think you should do with your life is not what this country was built on. And I think that most of us understand that from a pretty basic place. But, you know, people are busy outside the Beltway, outside the DC bubble. People are busy, they're living their lives, they're raising their children, they're going to work, they're getting out of the rain, they're doing whatever they're doing. But this is really affecting women on a daily basis, and we need to figure out a better way to tell that story. And I think we are, as Katie was saying.
I'm going to venture a couple of guesses. It's obviously a big question about where this is all coming from. I'm going to just lay out patriarchy as my first response. I thought that would get a laugh. No patriarchy laugh? Okay, that's fine. I want to say specifically, though, in the last couple of years, I think that there is this idea somehow that the state-level development of anti-abortion legislation was somehow an organic response to district-level demands for how to restrict abortion effectively. I think the sort of more accurate way to describe what's happened in the states over the last 5 to 6 years is Americans United for Life, an incredibly influential draft legislation machine that's in Washington, D.C., producing draft legislation that they send to state legislatures across the country, and they say, you sign your name to the bottom of this, and you have a piece of legislation that says you can ban abortion at 20 weeks, that you can require a 24-hour waiting period. And I think it's disingenuous to talk about the state-level policies as if they are these sort of, grassroots initiatives, because I think that, we've talked a lot about what the polling shows, is that this is not actually on the top of most people's political agendas for what they think about for themselves and their families when they're thinking about what they want their elected officials to be really working on. So I think that, again, some of the work that's been happening within the reporting on this area is kind of exposing what those links are and where money that is funding these efforts is coming from. And it's often, these are not local efforts. These are not local people saying, I would like a 20-week ban because this is at the top of my 2016 agenda. So I think that's one of the pieces that doesn't get talked about quite enough, because we see these personalities, these particular lawmakers that become the kind of story of their legislation, but there's actually a lot going on behind them that we often don't get to see.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I also noticed the movement towards safety being the key phrase to justify restrictions. Who doesn't support safety, right? Safety is the easiest thing to try to swing someone's opinion about a procedure. It clearly has been shown, and clearly what Stephanie argued, none of these restrictions support a safer procedure, a safer outcome. Abortion is one of the safest, most commonly performed procedures in the country. It is so rare to find a complication from an abortion that one of the, I think, restrictions they were trying with Whole Women's Health was an abortion provider has to get hospital privileges, but the reason a lot of them couldn't get hospital privileges is because they didn't have enough cases that were getting admitted through the emergency department because they just didn't have that many complications to prove that they needed admitting privileges. So what else is going to prove that the procedure's safe? The false notion that abortion needs to be legislated because it's unsafe. Once you get that in the public mind, it's very hard to shake that. It's like negative, negative together, then those things must be bad. Abortion must be unsafe. It's very hard to uncouple, which is why I don't know how to do it, but medical information really needs to be spread in a broader sense, and I don't know how to make that palatable to the general public, but it's very unfortunate.
I think it's also important to keep in mind that opposition to women's reproductive autonomy is not widespread. 7 in 10 Americans supports access to safe abortion care. The proponents of these anti-abortion restrictions are a minority, but they're a well-organized and well-funded minority that have created an incredible propaganda machine. And I think, this is my personal belief, I think half the politicians out there enacting these laws are personally ambivalent about abortion. They're just looking for the campaign funds and the political support from these organized interest groups. So I think, the task is on us to energize, mobilize, and engage with the vast majority of the public that is pro-choice, that cares about women's access to reproductive health care, and help them understand why that is in jeopardy and why this is such a critical moment for action.
I think your point is actually leads to my next question. It's about some solutions, right? And education, and also centering the voices of women who are experiencing this. What are some other ways in which we can push against this loud minority of people in opposition to this?
Well, 2 weeks ago, Catholics for Choice launched a national campaign called Abortion in Good Faith, which lifts up the individual voices of everyday Catholics. We have a student, a nurse, a healthcare, a cancer researcher, a former nun who was a school teacher for many years, saying, I believe that abortion and public funding for abortion is a Catholic social justice value. We put ads in the newspapers in 20 different outlets, in English and Spanish. We have a website, ingoodfaith.us, please go there. And I think that that was part and parcel of the work that All Above All and others have done to lift up the voices of those affected, to lift up the voices of those who can push back against that vocal but small minority who say, no, 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 and who want really to control women's lives, mm-hmm. right? It is about patriarchy, but it also is about Henry Hyde's comment that Jen read before he passed his amendment, or why he passed his amendment, was about he wants to control the people he has power to control. Oftentimes that's poor women, oftentimes that's women of color, oftentimes that's younger women, and we need to not let them.
Yeah. Anyone else have any? I know, I mean, personally for me, it's we would have a woman representing us in every area. It's my Action Fund endorsement there.
I think that funding Planned Parenthood would help. Just saying.
What was that? Sorry.
So I also think that funding Planned Parenthood would help. I'm just saying.
Yeah, it's interesting. We say, like, this is... I mean, this is a minority, but that we're going to defund Planned Parenthood and we're going to roll back Roe v. Wade, that is literally the conservatives' like number one or number two talking point. And that tends to work even for people who believe in access to reproductive health care and believe, even women who believe that that should be a solution. And that is penetrating. That's so, it's so confusing to me. And I wonder why and how we see that taking airspace.
One going back to the solution question, you say one of the things we don't hear a lot about is folks talking about abortion, and it's I think in large part because of the stigma around surrounding abortion. So sometimes you'll have conversations like these, political conversations, policy conversations, legal conversations, but a lot of times people are afraid to have conversations with the folks they know, their friends, their family, their neighbors, their coworkers, about abortion. And we're starting to see that change a little bit with brave folks coming out and talking about their abortion story. I think of things like Advocates for Youth 1 in 3 campaign, the campaign you're talking about, other things. And they don't have to be a woman who's had an abortion herself. Can be, but can also be the man who supported a woman who's had an abortion. It can be the brother or the father or the mother of someone who has sister who have supported somebody who has had an abortion and talking about what that has meant for that person and their life and what that experience has felt like. And sometimes I think those conversations, sure, people should vote and people should write their congressperson and they should do all things, but sometimes I think some of the most effective action can be changing the way our society thinks and talks about abortion, and that can begin at home, in your apartment building, with your friends and your neighbors.
That's great. And Katie, I want to ask you, do you think it's been helpful, or how has it been more helpful in having this conversation, having more representation of women, and also particularly women of color, in the media talking about these stories and talking about what's happening?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's just in beyond just even abortion or reproductive rights, it's good to have a media and a government that is reflective of the country that it is supposed to either be documenting or representing, which is why in my own reporting, I cover politics generally, including reproductive health issues. But when I think about this election and the ways in which the questions that we have around abortion policy are connected to the questions that we have around representative government. And so when we think about our government districts and we think about gerrymandering and the way that states have apportioned districts to suit their interests in getting reelected less than having a representative district, when I think about voting rights, these, you know, I think that, you know, it is often more complicated than just write your congressperson get out and vote, but I think that when you look at the sort of policy landscape right now, you see a government that is increasingly not representative of its people and their interests. And so I think that we now have a moment in which a lot of these issues, I think, on the political scene are coming together and being seen as the kind of matrix that they are of intertwined issues. So I think just moving forward, you just have a kind of awareness and maybe interaction between these different spaces that I think produces, it will potentially produce different outcomes politically. But again, it's like, I think we're just kind of on the verge of that right now. And I'm as interested as you guys are to see what will happen.
Mm-hmm. You talk about outcomes, and that makes me pose the question of, in our perfect world, right, what would this world look like in regards to women being able to make decisions for their lives? That is a great outcome, but how, if we're shifting the tide, what does that perfect world look like, and who is that centering, and how are we having this conversation?
This sort of ties into the last question as well, but in a perfect world, I think any woman in any state who needs to seek health care to terminate a pregnancy doesn't have to find the right health care provider in the right office that's willing to do a procedure for her. Another area that clearly Planned Parenthood has been targeting, not only through direct service provision, but through training, is training new generations of abortion providers. So if the numbers aren't there for people to provide the services, the patients aren't going to get them, the services that they do need, and they have to undo, the burden is great for them to try to find those services. But there's a lot of movements that are funding training programs for OBGYN and family medicine doctors to get abortion care training. And one of the things that we're doing in the hospital in central Brooklyn is bringing in a training program so that residents that are going through their routine OBGYN training that are not required to perform first trimester or second trimester abortions, they're now required to go through a rotation where they have to be part of counseling women, getting to know their stories, understanding why they're seeking abortion care. It is their choice as a trainee whether or not they go into the operating room or not. But in terms of the post-abortion care, they need to provide those services, they need to understand complications of abortion care, and know how to provide contraception. Once we normalize it among providers, which is absurd that you think someone would go through a medical training program and not be part of a basic healthcare process or be able to provide that or get the training they would need in case they had to provide it. Once we normalize it among the providers and all the trainees coming up, then you have a legion of people that can talk frankly with their patients about reproductive choices when they come in with a new pregnancy and they're trying to make a decision about what's right for them. So many patients feel isolated because their doctor just assumes it's a positive pregnancy test, we'll go to the prenatal clinic. It's absurd the way that patients are treated. Their autonomy is completely taken away from them, and when the medical institution just reinforces that, clearly they feel crippled by their own limited decision. So certainly providing expanded training and expanded services where women are not limited by their encounter with the medical institution is part of the perfect world.
I also think in a perfect world, clinicians and doctors won't have to deal with a mind-boggling array of medically unnecessary requirements, red tape, hoops to jump through, and so on. In so many states in this country right now, before a woman can have an abortion, her doctor has to provide her with medically inaccurate disclosures about the procedure. So in some parts of the country, doctors have to tell their patients, abortion increases the risk of breast cancer, even though every credible study to look at this issue has determined that it's absolutely not true. There is absolutely no link between abortion and breast cancer. But doctors have to tell their patients this. They have to tell their patients that abortion increases the risk of suicidal ideation, even though there's absolutely no support for this proposition. In South Dakota, doctors have to tell their patients, and I keep saying doctors because in all of these states, there are arbitrary limitations on who can provide abortions, and it's only doctors. Even though in some parts of the country, physician assistants, nurse midwives, nurse practitioners provide abortions, and they do it with the same safety and professionalism as doctors. But in these states with restrictive laws, it's just doctors. And in South Dakota, doctors have to tell their patients that abortion, quote, terminates the life of a whole separate, unique, living human being. Are you sure you want to have this procedure? I mean, it's ridiculous, and in a perfect world, it wouldn't be. And hopefully, in the world that we live in, soon it will no longer be.
Mm-hmm. I think in the world we want, for sure, every woman who wants to have an abortion can have one. But also, in the world we want, a woman has all the tools she needs to be able to prevent pregnancy if she wants to. A woman has the ability to have a child if she wants to. She has the ability to get good maternity care if she wants to. If she has the ability to raise her family at a decent living wage. She has the ability to have her children be in safe, good schools. She has the ability to get child care for her kids if she needs one. All of those things are the things we need if we're going to truly have reproductive justice.
Go ahead.
I think that there's the details of what we want the perfect world to look like, regulatory and legislatively and policy. There's the reality of people's lives, and then there's the ideation, right? And I think the idealization. We want a perfect world where every person has autonomy over their own body, mm-hmm. where respect for women and men's moral agency is constant, where true religious freedom, meaning that respect for my conscience is not usurped by my politician, my priest, or anyone, mm-hmm. that my religious beliefs and my right to exercise my conscience is total. Mm.
So I'm looking at our time. I'm going to ask one more question, and this is how I also like to end any conversation, is a call to action. What can we, everyone in this room, I know we obviously work in this every single day, what can we do to help advance this conversation, chip away at that opposition towards women having the autonomy and the agency over their bodies? What is it that we can do? While you're thinking of it, my simple thing is to vote. And if you're not registered, to register to vote and make sure someone else is registered. But voting for me is the number one step. But if there's a call to action that any of you have, or also any final words as we wrap up the panel.
I'll start just so I can be done. So I think there's three things. You can talk about it, talk about abortion, talk about reproductive health, talk about the things you've heard tonight, talk about the things that you think are important. Talk about it with your neighbors, talk about it with your healthcare providers, talk about it with those folks who disagree with you, because that's equally important. Can write about it, write your letters to the editor when there's a story that you don't agree with, write to your congressman or state legislator about the laws that you want or don't, and we can vote about it.
I would say stay engaged with the organizations that are represented on this panel and other organizations working in the field of reproductive health and justice. Join their mailing lists, keep track of what's going on, and provide support where you can. If you're in a position to provide financial support, then do that. And regardless of whether you're in a position to provide financial support, when you get an email encouraging you to write your congressperson and support this bill or oppose this bill or speak out in favor of this policy or against this policy, try to do that because it really does matter.
I think just briefly, I think the single most important thing is to be a voice for people that feel that they don't have a voice in this, the women that are prejudicially excluded from basic health care. If you hear a conversation, be brave, be bold,
speak what you feel is right, what you know is right. It is easier to be quiet, which is why I think this has become such a polarized issue. Pro-life, pro-choice. We know it's way more complex than that. So be bold, talk about the complexity, talk about the challenges, keep the conversation going. The more people think about it, the more room they have to think, not just with logic and law, with their hearts as well. And that is far more powerful. Women need to be humanized, which is a really sad thing to think about, but it's just true. So just keep the conversations going.
I don't want to be here for the 41st anniversary of the Hyde Amendment. So you can find out a lot about the Hyde Amendment on the allaboveall.org website. We at the ACLU also have a petition on our website to tell your congressperson to support the Each Woman Act, which would roll back Hyde. I agree with all the other things on the panel, but with this being the 40th anniversary of Hyde, I couldn't let that go.
Any final words, Katie, or?
I guess because I don't come from it from an activist space, I can only just speak to informing yourself about what your views are and trying to just be sure that what your representatives are saying is accurate and what is being called medical policy has a medical basis. I think those things are just good as citizens, that we feel like those things are reflected in our laws. So I guess that would be my main takeaway.
Well, thank you all. This has been so informative. I could talk about this all day, all week, all year. But I want to thank Stephanie, Sarah, Dr. Oli, Katie, and Jen for your time and not only your support for Planned Parenthood and the healthcare that we provide, but really centering the women who are in need of these services, who don't have the privilege of being on this stage or in this room. So thank you so much.